The truth is we didn't know what topic to speak about. So the best thing is to speak about what you want me to. So it could be either questions and answers in several different topics, or I can force you to listen to a lecture and hopefully you'll like it, whichever you like, so whichever way you prefer. Now I know you have a weekly lecture here, weekly or monthly, what is it? Weekly, Baruch Hashem, and you say it's Leilui Nishmad?
Yigal Ben Zakiya.
Yigal?
Ben Zakiya.
Ben Zakiya. And not that many times I had an opportunity to speak and see the water. Remind me of my childhood. We lived right by the ocean in Israel. And Baruch Hashem, some nice breeze. So maybe I'm going to be able to give a better lecture tonight, thanks to the condition. I was given different kinds of topics. One of them, we wanted to speak about the how to handle tragedies. After a week after the tragedy that happened, in general, how to handle tragedies. The second topic was how to be happy, how to reach happiness in life. Third topic was days of Mashiach, what's going to happen when the Mashiach comes, before and after. And if you have any other topic that you would like to add, now it's the time. Any suggestion? Anything? No? Any? Should I choose for you?
May I suggest maybe the 3 weeks are coming. Maybe like how the tragedy kind of goes into the 3 weeks, how it kind of like goes together a little bit. That type of thing.
Well, you know, now we are started actually 3 weeks of the destruction of the temple. Going back, remember there's two temples were destroyed in Tisha B'Av. The first one was by the Babylonians and the second one by the Romans. Which destruction is worse? The second one, because the first one had a recovery. It was 410 years, and then 7 years later everything went back to normal, and then we have a second temple. Altogether, the two temples was 830 years of Beit HaMikdash. We can give hundreds of lectures about things that used to take place in Beit HaMikdash, in the Holy Temple, the miracles, how close Jews were to Hashem. Everybody who came and saw what's happening there right away became very strong spiritually. But that's a whole different topic. But the one thing we have to know, that the first temple was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon, Babel. The second temple by the Romans. But the first temple, it's actually interesting how HaKadosh Baruch Hu did it to us. 11 years before, there was a king called Jehoiakim. You see in the Tanakh, most Jews don't know who he was, except some main scholars that learned the Tanakh very well. This was a very, very wicked king. 2,600 years ago, imagine even today you don't have wicked people like this. Even today, when today normally people are much more wicked, what really happened is, he used to take the Sefer Torah and take a knife, a sharp knife, and cut the names of Hashem out of the Sefer Torah and throw it into the fire. This is how he used to do. That was his fun. Most kings, they're very busy with things in life. They have wars, they have financial issues, meetings, people, all kinds of things to run their country. He was so bored and so wicked that he was taking the scroll of the Torah. The scroll of the Torah has 304,805 letters. And it takes an average sofer between 1 and 2 years to write. It takes a very long process. You dip the feather inside the ink, you write one letter, then another one, and another one, and another one. Almost 305,000 letters. Then he comes with a knife, he goes around the name of Hashem, take it out, make holes in the Sefer Torah. Of course, once you take one name out, the Sefer Torah is Pasul, and throwing it into the fire. He was in charge of Eretz Israel. When Nebuchadnezzar occupied the whole world, all he wanted is money. Money runs the world, always the same thing. He said to the Jews, you want to stay in power? You want to continue to pray in your temple? On one condition. you have to pay me X amount of tax every year. I don't care. This is what I want. You are the king. Your name is Jehoiakim. You make sure by this date I get my money. You pay me back my money. You pay me my money. I leave you alone. I don't touch you. You don't pay, you have a problem. I come, I burn the whole place. So this Jehoiakim rebelled against him. He came to Eretz Israel, and the rabbis came to him and said, wait, before you destroyed everything here, why we should suffer? We are all innocent. This is the person you have a problem with. We agree to pay you taxes. We don't want to rebel against you. No problem, we respect you. You're the king of the world. We'll pay you the taxes and finish. Just what? You have a problem with him. So get him out of power. So he said to the Jews, no problem. You know what? Give him to me. Instead of coming to a war, find him where he's hiding. Give him to me. I'll take him to Babylon, and I'll take care of him, and I won't touch you. I put a different king, someone who is loyal. And the Jews came and talked, and the rabbis came, all the rabbis. They grabbed him, and they brought him out. They said, we're giving you to the Nebuchadnezzar. Start saying Kaddish for your soul already. So he told them, rabbis, what kind of rabbis you are? Don't you know we have a rule in the Torah, if the Goyim ambush a Jewish city and they ask for a Jew, give us a Jew and we leave you alone or we kill all of you. What does the Torah say? You're not allowed to give them any Jew. You die. Everybody dies and no, not giving them a Jew. So you want to turn me in? What kind of rabbis you are? So the rabbis told him, you forgot one detail. This halakha, this law, applies only when they ask for one Jew, but they don't say which one. But if they come and say, like today, FBI, Secret Service, IRS, you know, military army, police, whatever it is, we want that plony, this individual. He has to be arrested. Murder, rape, stealing, whatever the case is. If they come and mention the name and they hold him guilty of a crime, you turn him in. Especially somebody wicked like you, that it's a mitzvah to turn you in. So what are you saying? So they grabbed him and gave him to Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar took this Jehoiakim to Babel and took care of him. What did he do? He took his son and put him the king. Then his advisor told him, what kind of a smart king you are? What kind of a smart king? You put his son, as soon as his son gained power, he will revenge his father's death. You have to put somebody else, somebody that will be loyal to you. So right away, he got rid of his son, and he made Tzidkiyahu the king. Now Tzidkiyahu was a righteous king, and he was the king 11 years. But when Nebuchadnezzar sent Jehoiakim to Babylon, he took all the rabbis with him, all the chief rabbis of Israel, and threw them out of Israel and sent them to Babel, to Iraq, to Babylon. That was 11 years before Tzidkiyahu decided also to rebel against Nebuchadnezzar. After 11 years, he was paying him taxes, and Nebuchadnezzar did not touch the temple. All they wanted is money. Money, money, money. It's not like with the Greeks. The Greeks didn't want money. They wanted to turn the Jews to become Goyim. The Romans was all physical debt. The Babylonian, physical debt. But the Greeks only want to turn us to become like them. Don't want to kill us. You say that you want to become a Greek? We will give you a reward. We'll give you rights. You'll be in a Congress. You sit in a government. You can be anything. Democracy. Whatever, like all over the world. Just say that you're one of us. Say that you are American, not a Jew. You are American. You're loyal to America. You are Iranian. You have nothing to do with the state of Israel. No problem. We'll promote you. With this, you know, no racism here. And that was the whole thing, to destroy the Torah. But here, come Nebuchadnezzar, he wants money. After 11 years, the advisor of King Tzidkiyahu, they say to him, what kind of king you are? We're paying them millions of dollars. We're talking 2,600 years ago. How much more money are we going to give this wicked king? He owned the whole world. He owned the whole world. How much more money we give him? Don't you see what a wicked king is? He take an animal, rip the chicken apart, and eat it raw without even killing the animal. That's called Ever Min HaChai. One of the seven laws that applies to the Goyim, that they're not allowed to kill an animal before it's completely dead. Now you may think, who is the fool who will eat a raw animal? Who? Take anybody in the world, tell him, come, eat this raw whatever, cat, mice. Unless if it's Chinese, that they like to eat the worms when they're alive, and the cockroach. They like to eat them when they're alive. They take them with a spoon in a barrel. Somebody comes with a bicycle in Thailand, in China, and everybody run, and they grab it, and they and open up their mouth, and all the worms are making celebration inside. And that's, you know, that's, yeah. But still, like a chicken, take a chicken and rip him apart, or take his head and take it apart and eat it. It sounds very barbaric, but people used to have strong desire for it in those days. That's why it's one of the restrictions in the Torah for the Goyim, not to do such a thing. You kill an animal, you stab the animal, you chop the head off, no problem. After the animal is dead, even though it's nevela and a Jew cannot eat it, even the Muslims don't eat nevelot. The Muslim only eats slaughtered animals and certain animals. But if you shoot an animal, like if you shoot a deer in upstate, the Muslims will not eat it. But Christians eat it. But Jews and Muslims don't eat it. But Jews have the oral laws, which is all the way to check the animals, the lung, the knife, to check the knife, where to slaughter. There's many oral laws that Hashem gave Moshe with the written Torah, which the Goyim don't have. So anyway, the advisor of Tzidkiyahu said, don't you see what a wicked person is? We paying money to this midget who eats raw animal like this? Let's rebel against him. Prophet Yirmiyahu was the prophet of that time. This is in Tisha B'Av, when we sit on the floor, we read how Prophet Yirmiyahu saw Yerushalayim is burning, and he was running crying, and all the fire came from Tisha B'Av all the way to the tent of Av. The flame of Bet HaMikdash was still going, and most of Bet HaMikdash was burned in the next day, on Asara B'Av. That's why the Sfaradim, they don't take haircut until the end of the tent of Av. When Tisha B'Av is over at night, still, they don't shave and don't take haircut only the next day. Why? Because really most of the tragedy was the next day. So anyway, this king, Tzidkiyahu, did not listen to Yirmiyahu. Yirmiyahu told him, if you're going to rebel against Nebuchadnezzar, he will take you to Babel. He's telling him a prophecy. He's going to take you to Babylon, but you're not going to see Babel. You won't be able to see it. And he didn't understand what kind of prophecy is going to take me to Babel, but I won't be able to see Babel. It's like saying to someone, I'll take you on a tour to New York. An Israeli guy, come, I'll take you to New York, but you won't be able to see New York. It's a conflict. Doesn't make sense. So he didn't listen to the warning. He rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar, and the rest is history. They came to Jerusalem, and they slaughter thousands of thousands of thousands of Jews, rivers of blood, because of greed to money. That's what most of the Jews in upstate sitting in jail. You know how many Jews sitting in a camp, in prison? Very respectable people with nice ties from great, great families. IRS fraud, insurance fraud, stock market fraud, money laundering. The jails are full of it. Why? Because the Jews have no emunah in Hashem. They may have a beautiful yarmulke and a nice beard, but none of them have 1% emunah in Hashem. Someone who knows Hashem gives them money, he needs to make tricks, he needs to cheat, he needs to deceive people, he needs to make insurance fraud and cheat the insurance that they send him money. This is, it's all against the Torah. So what, just not to eat pork? Rabbi, you kill me, I don't eat pork. But to steal is a much bigger sin. It's a double sin. To eat pork is only a sin for yourself. To steal from somebody, it's a double sin. It's the stealing and actually hurting the person. Person is sitting, crying, eating his heart. It's a chain reaction. You eat pork, nobody suffers besides yourself. You steal from a person, it's his 10 children. It's his grandchildren. It's his wife. It's so many things. It could be his employees. His company go bankrupt. You can hurt hundreds of people with the greed to money. Them here, Beit HaMikdash was really destroyed in the end because he did not pay them the tax. Now, this is the time to, since we're already speaking about Nebuchadnezzar, many of us have a doubt about the next world. We ask ourselves, all these promises that the rabbis made in a Gemara, the righteous people, they're going to heaven, they're enjoying from Hashem. How do we know that it's really real? How do I know that when the day I leave, I'm going to really get paid for all my Shabbat that I kept, for all the mitzvot, for modesty, for living according to Hashem rules? How do I really know? Believing, yes, it's all belief. But to know, how do we know? One of the things, in the time that Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon, there was, prior to the story of the destruction, who was the prophet? Prophet Yeshaya, Isaiah, Prophet Yeshaya. And who was the king of Israel? The most righteous king in the history. We never had in the history of the Jewish people, except Moshe Rabbeinu, which was a prophet. I'm talking king, official king. We never had a righteous king with so much achievement like King Hezekiah. And in his generation was one of the main Nevi'im, the main prophet, Yeshaya. They were in the same time. King Hezekiah did not want to get married. Why he didn't want to get married? Because he saw in his vision that he's going to have a wicked son. He saw in a vision, he's a very holy man, he saw a vision that he's going to have a son named Menashe. And this Menashe is going to be a very, very wicked king instead of him. He's going to make idols, he's going to turn the Jews away from Hashem. So he said, it's better I will die lonely, without a wife and children. I will die lonely all my life. I won't touch a woman. Now remember, this is in a generation that a righteous Jew never dare to touch a finger of a woman, unless if she's his wife. If she's my wife, fine, it's kosher. If she's not my wife, every fool understands that this is an Isur Karet in those days. Today, people have a lot of questions. Rabbi, how do I know? But today, 2,600 years ago, every average Jew knew it's better to die than to even touch the hand of a woman. Why? She's nida, a single woman. She's nida all her life. The Torah says that a man that have relationship with a single guy and a single girl, that have relation even one time, even for 1 second, even after a second, they change their mind, they regret it, they never finish the scene. Just one time. Both of them lose their share to the world to come, have no eternity. Ve'nichreta nefesh ha'im Yisrael. The Torah say, God say, because of that sin, that they never got officially married according to my Torah, I cut these two souls from the afterlife and they have no share to the world to come. What is it called? Isur Karet. There are 36 restrictions like this in the Torah. That the Torah comes and say, and someone who make that sin, ונחרטה הנפש ההיא מישראל. Translation, I cut that soul out of my nation. You not belong to my nation anymore. For what? 5 minutes of pleasure. And another 5 minutes of pleasure. And another 10 minutes of pleasure. Add all this pleasure. 5 years of sins. How much pleasure? 3 days, 10 days, all together. For 5 or 10 days of pleasure, he lost his eternity. No share to the world to come. All the mitzvot he did, he will get paid in this life, and his children will benefit from it. But his gate to heaven is permanently closed, unless, if he made tshuva and regretted deeply, and never ever repeat that sin. That's a different story. Tshuva, it's a miracle remedy that HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave the nation of Israel. But 36th restriction, among them, eating chametz in Pesach. How many Jews know that by drinking beer in Pesach, they basically cut themselves out of eternity? How many Jews knows about it? Rabbi, what did I eat? I tasted from spaghetti a little bit in Pesach. What's the big deal? I eat kosher all my life. I went to yeshiva. My father is the chief rabbi of Brooklyn. I tasted a little bit beer. They offered me whiskey in a cocktail party. I was embarrassed to tell my boss no. So he gave me a little whiskey. So I drank a little whiskey. Knowing it's a sin and drinking it on Pesach, it's one of the 36. What else? Who knows? Worshipping an idol. They put Buddha on a table and say, you give you $1 million. All you have to do is bow down and that's it. Here is $1 million cash. A person must die and not agree to bow down even 1 second to this. Even of course he doesn't believe in this nonsense. Of course he makes fun and all these idols worshippers. But they offer him a lot of money. Let's see, it's in a movie. It's in a movie. He has an act in a movie. And in a movie he has to bow down to an idol. He can never agree to such a thing. There is no forgiveness to such a thing. It's very difficult. And that's called Avodah Zarah. And one more thing, Mechalel Shabbat. Most Jews don't know it. A Jew that violates the laws of Shabbat purposely, which means he knows not allowed to drive, not allowed to turn the electric on, not allowed to smoke, not allowed to cook, not allowed to sew, to write, etc. And, Rabbi, we're traditional. We're not so religious, Rabbi. My grandfather in Syria was a very holy man. But, you know, they lived in a primitive life. There's no car. He had a donkey. Now we are here in an ocean parkway. We live in nice houses. We drive nice car. Look at my watch. You want me not to sew on Shabbat? Or you want me not to write or type on my computer? What work it is, Rabbi? In the old days, people needed, until they make fire. But today, we press a button and the fire is here. We don't even have to do most of these things. The machine does everything. What's the problem, Rabbi, right? This is what we hear everywhere you go. These kind of comments come from complete ignorance. Because Shabbat has nothing to do with hard work. A person can kill himself working physically the whole Shabbat until he faints. He has no more energy. Carry tables on his back, going to upstairs in his house, bringing it down, bringing boxes of drinks, going up and down, service guests. Believe me, 5 pounds he lost in this Shabbat just from hard work. He did not violate Shabbat even once. A person turned the light on once, right away fall into this category of Mechalel Shabbat b'mezid. Why Hashem is so strict about it? Why Jews dare to be Mechalel Shabbat? Only one reason. I don't find in my whole 16 years that I speak, and I spoke in thousands of places already, I really don't find evil Jews, bad people. Yeah, everyone has Yetzer Hara. None of us is perfect. But usually people are not really evil. In time of problem, everyone try to help, phone calls, coming, helping, whatever. People are good in general. Why are they doing such a sin? Who knew here before I came here? Please raise his hand. Who knew that according to God, we all try to do what Hashem wants us to do? Who knew that to be Mechalel Shabbat is a bigger sin than to be a murderer? Raise his hand. Who knew? Only two people. And we have a lot of people here. Only two people, and this is, we all of us traditional, from what I've seen, or from traditional families. Only two Jews knew that actually to kill a person, it's a very big sin. Don't get the wrong idea here. Very bad sin. Everybody looks at this crazy murderer that murdered that innocent lady last week. And if he would come near you, you would vomit. You don't even want to be with him in the same room. If you had to go to the court to testify, looking in his monster face, you won't even agree to do it just because you don't want to stand next to him. But our best friends and brothers and sisters in Shamayim are bigger sinners than him. And I'm talking, assuming he's normal. From what I've seen, he took all kinds of drug cocktails and he has mental issues. He's an adopted kid. From what I hear, he was an Italian kid that his parents threw him out and a Jewish family adopted him. And he's under all kinds of anti-depression brain medicine. And he stopped taking the medicine. And he drugged the boy with 4 different kinds of drugs. He may not be normal, this guy, but assuming he was perfectly normal, what he did, which is one of the worst tragedies in our history, we don't remember that somebody cut a kid and put him in a freezer. Even in the movies, you don't see things like this. In reality, that's not as bad as a Jew who's mechalel Shabbat in the eyes of God. And if you want to challenge me, 100% I will prove it to you, without a doubt. Being mechalel Shabbat in the eyes of God is a bigger sin than what this man did. Now, if you are shocked, allow me 5 minutes to prove it to you. We have to know the truth. I know it's not pleasant to hear it. None of us wants to be in a category worse than this monster. But let me prove it to you. If we go to court and we find two criminals, each one came out of a different courtroom. One of them got 50 years in prison without parole. We don't know what he did. And the other one got 2 months volunteer work in a hospital and $1,000 penalty. Now, we don't know what sin they made. Now, somebody comes to me and say, if you tell me which criminal is worse, he made a bigger crime, I will give you $1 million cash. Would you gamble? I say, of course. It's like finding $1 million on the street. I don't know what they did. How much this guy got? 50 years in prison without parole? And this one 2 months in hospital with $1,000? Probably drove without a license or something. What can it be? 2 months in hospital. So right away I say, this guy's 50 years? That's for sure a bigger criminal. What is my chances to be wrong? Two people came out of the courtroom. One just received 50 years in prison, the worst prison, no discount, no parole, no appealing, no nothing. And the other one, 2 months volunteering in a hospital across the street. Would I be wrong to swear on my life that the first one who got 50 years in prison is a bigger criminal? There's any chance that I'm wrong? What do you think? How?
Insider trading can get you 50 years, but something like, let's say...
I know a few people with insider trading, they don't get 50 years. They get maximum 4 or 5 years. They lose a lot of money, but 4 or 5 years they get. Here, every week you have inside trading, 2.5 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years if it was really big amount, millions of dollars. They don't get that much. You're right, in America there's no common sense in the court system. You're right, 100%. Because an insider trading sometimes get like a rapist. Same thing, this doesn't make sense. You're right about what you say. But I'm now talking, a person came 50 years and this guy got 2 months. I would go with the 50 years that it's a much, thank you, that it's a much bigger crime. When we go in the Ten Commandments, the Ten Commandments, which is the constitution of every place in the world today, even in the United States, you should not kill, you should not steal, come from the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments go from the most important mitzvah to the least important mitzvah. The first one, I am your God. That's the foundation of everything. No God is no nothing. First rule, remember, I am your God. What's the second rule? There is no other God but me. Right away, you should know, I'm your boss and there's no partners. I don't have a son, I don't have a cousin, I don't have a wife, I don't have anything. I am the boss of this whole world. I was always here before you and I will be here after you, and there's no other partners in running the show. I am the one. What do we know already? There is a boss, and he is the only boss. What's the third one? I'm not your friend from high school. Where does it say it in the Ten Commandments? Don't carry my name just like that. I'm not your friend. I'm your boss. I'm also your father, because you're Jewish. That's a different story. I chose you to be my children. But I'm a very strict father, very strict. If you don't believe me, read Sefer Dvarim, 10 minutes read, if he's strict or not, and you come to the right conclusion. And don't be fooled by any other rabbis. They tell you, don't worry, you're okay, you're making Kiddush and Shabbos. Don't worry, you light candles. What? Look at the good. Why are you looking at the bad? Enough with this nonsense. Come on, let's not lie to ourselves. This rabbi wants your money. Don't worry, I don't want your money. And even if you want to give me, I don't want. Please, don't give anything. No donation, no money. I just want you to wake up. That's all. I mean, I don't know what, maybe you're more religious than me. I don't know. Maybe I'm even talking to myself. I have to wake up myself from time to time. I'm talking generally, speaking. People who are watching the website all over the world, they wake up. What's the point? Third one, do not swear or do not carry my name unless if it's in a court with the permission of the Jewish court. Other than that, you're not allowed to say Elo, also him. You're not allowed. You want to say my name, you say Elohim with Kuf. Why? That's not my name. It's just a nickname. Or you want to say the Yud, Hey, and Vav, and Hey, you don't say it. You're not allowed to say it. You call it a different name. And even that different name, you say Hashem. You don't say the way it is, Aleph, Dalet, Nun, and Yud. You're not allowed to say these names. They are very holy. So you're calling me with names that it's really not my names. Because if you use my name, it only has to be with permission. So that's the three really, the first three commandments are really one subject. There's one God, no other, and he is the boss and you have to respect him. This is really one thing. What comes the fourth one? The fourth one is, I made a covenant between me, the master of universe, to this nation, the nation of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, their children, the Hebrews. I made an agreement, a covenant. I'm choosing you to be my children. I'm going to give you a huge reward for following my instruction in the afterlife for eternity. There is no end to the reward that I'm going to give you, but also very severe punishments if you're going to rebel against me and you'll be ungrateful. One way or the other, it's your choice. I'm giving you the life and the good, the bad and the death, and you should choose the good. Choose means it's 100% in your hand. What is it? The covenant is Shabbat. And the nation of Israel observed the Sabbath to make the Sabbath an eternal covenant. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's an eternal covenant for eternity. Because I created the world in 6 days, in a 7 day I rested. No Jew have permission to violate my Shabbat. It's an eternal covenant, eternal agreement. You want to belong to my nation? That's condition number one. Condition number one, you first have to be a Shomer Shabbos. If not, how does the Torah continue? I'm reading you from the Torah. I didn't write the Torah. If you have any complaints, please send an email to Hashem, not to me. I only read. I'm a postman. Deliver you the letter. That's all. I deliver the letter and I go back to my business. You have a problem, address the writer of the letter. Send him back an email. Hashem, I'm not accepting your rules. It's annoying me. You are annoying me. Give me the oxygen. Give me the money. Give me my fancy house. Give me my nice jewelry. And don't bother me. I don't want to do anything for you. Just give me. You want from me? Leave me alone. I'm not interested. That's how people talk, basically. Or that's how they think. Just give. I don't want to do anything. So, what does the Torah continue? The Torah say, and if a Jew does not keep the Shabbat, who knows? What's the rest of the Pasuk? What's the rest of the verse? What is it? No? Anybody knows? Nobody knows. You don't know or you don't want to know? Huh? What do you think? They know or they don't want to know? Should I say or should I be more lenient? Huh?
Say it.
Only if you promise me not to get angry.
Say it.
Yeah? Alright. And a Jew that does not keep the Sabbath should be put to death by stoning with no mercy and have no share to the world to come. I cut his soul out of my next life for breaking the eternal covenant that I made with my children. ונכרתה הנפש ההיא מישראל, מחלל שבת. Now, in case you still are not convinced, the Torah say, a Jew that does not keep Shabbat, how is he considered in his status in Shamayim? Is he a Jew or a non-Jew? What do you think? His mother is Miriam, very religious woman. His father is Yosef, very religious woman, the Gabbai of the Shul. But he has an earring and a ponytail and tattoo and drive his BMW to play golf on Shabbat. Traditional. Once in a while he takes this white yarmulke, put it on his ponytail when he comes to bar mitzvah. Maybe sometimes he even holds sidur once in a while. But that's it. He doesn't keep Shabbat. According to Hashem right now, is he considered to be a Jew or a Goy? What do you think? What is he? If you don't know, open Shulchan Aruch, the Jewish book of law. In 7 different chapters, it repeats the same thing. There's no contradiction. Mechalel Shabbat, harehu kegoy lechol davar. A mechalel Shabbos is 100% like a goy. If he touched the wine, you cannot make kiddush with this wine anymore. No wine, no kiddush. We'll do on the bread. No bread, we'll do kiddush without anything. Just saying Hashem, that's it. That's it, but no, we cannot do. Why? A great Jew, the Prime Minister of Israel. I don't know, the nicest person on earth. Very great manners. Everything, a great husband, a great father, an honest politician, but drives on Shabbat. Smoke a cigarette on Shabbat, talks on the phone, that's all, violate Shabbat. The Torah say, he cannot be a part of a minyan. You have 9 Jews, they want to take out the Torah in Kol Nidre, the most important hour of the year. 1,000 people in a synagogue, there's only 9 of them Shomer Shabbos. All the other 991 are not Shomer Shabbos. We're not allowed to take out the Torah. Not allowed to say Kaddish, not allowed to say Kedusha, not allowed to say Birkat Kohanim, not allowed any of this. Why? Because we don't have 10 Shomrei Shabbat. If a Mechalel Shabbat saw a murder, he saw someone murder another Jew, murdered another Jew, Hashem Yirachem, and he come to testify in Beit Din, they cannot let him speak. They say, we know you're not Shomer Shabbat, please get out of here. We cannot accept any testimony from you. Why? Hashem said, we don't have permission, we're sorry. Mechalel Shabbat, once alone from his friend, comes to his uncle is a big businessman, Shomer Shabbat, and he's not Shomer Shabbat. He said to his uncle, give me a loan, and I will pay you interest. I need it for my business. I need $200,000, I pay you $1,000 a month interest. The uncle is a religious Jew. Religious Jew, no, you're not allowed to give a loan and charge interest from any Jew. His uncle is allowed to give him a loan and kill him on the interest with no mercy. And it's not a sin. Why? Because it's not Shomer Shabbat. The Torah says you're not allowed to take interest from a Jew, but from a goy you are allowed. But his mother is a Jewish woman, but he doesn't keep Shabbat. That's why you're allowed to charge him interest, because according to the Torah, it's a serious problem. Believe me, there's much more to say, but I think you got the point. Now, if a person wants to finally connect with Hashem, rule number one is Shabbat. For a woman, there are 2 things in her life that is the most important thing. If she keeps those 2, she's for sure gonna end up in heaven, for sure. What is it? Modesty, number one, modesty, the way she dress and behave with men, and Shabbat. She has these 2, she has 90%. Everything else, kindness, kosher, tehillim, whatever you name it, it's not even 10%. Modesty and Shabbat is almost everything for a woman. I don't have time to explain it. You can go into my website. I give the proofs. By me, when I speak, I always have proofs. I don't say things that I think that's what it says. No. Any question you have, challenge me on the spot. I'll show you the source. The 6th commandment is you should not kill. The punishment of Mechalel Shabbat in the Torah, it's a worse punishment than the punishment of a murderer. How can it be? Hashem say Mechalel Shabbat getting a much worse punishment than a person who just killed another Jew and chopped him to pieces. According to the Torah, we don't care by the secular court. It's not following the law of Hashem. Here, this murderer, if they find that he was normal, will go to prison for the rest of his life. Mechalel Shabbat, the prosecutor probably will be a Jew, that Mechalel Shabbat, according to Hashem, is a much bigger sinner than this murderer. But he's going free. You know why? Because nobody cares about the laws of Hashem. Nobody cares. Who really cares that he violates Shabbat? Did you ever see a Jew that by mistake was Mechalel Shabbat and fall on the floor and cry? Our grandparents in Syria, Iraq, Iran, whatever it was, they knew what is it not to be Mechalel Shabbat. In the time of the Holocaust, the Nazis used to make the trials on Shabbat. They used to take the Jews and bring them to court, and then the audience is all German soldiers. The Jew is writing the protocol. The judge is a Jew. the defendants are all Jews. Everyone is Jews, but the audience is all Germans. That's how it used to be. And now they brought a woman. They brought an old woman. They blaming her that she took a loaf of bread and threw it above the fence to a Jew that was inside the camp. And supposedly somebody saw her, and now they are bringing her to justice. They ask her, ma'am, are you the one who threw the bread, like they say, the witnesses? She doesn't answer. The judge is a Jew. He say, please, we don't have time. Look, we have a lot of people here. Also, the police are Jews, the capo. The police are Jews, the judge is a Jew. The person who writes every word in the trial, supposedly they make it official, is also a Jew, and it's on Shabbat. They ask her 3-4 times, are you the one who gave the bread? People from the audience, some of her family members are screaming, Mom, it wasn't you. You were with us in a different place. Look how many people saw you over there. Answer. She doesn't speak. The German say to the judge, I don't have time. One last time. Yes or no? If no, we'll see. If yes, send her to die. He asked her, the Jewish judge, begging, tell me, speak, was it you or not? She doesn't answer. He say, death penalty, take her out. So as they're taking her out to die, her son come to her and say to her, Mom, there's no mitzvah in the Torah to commit suicide. Where does it say to give up life? A person has to give everything he can to live. Everything. He's not allowed to kill himself. If a person commits suicide, he's judged as a murderer that murdered himself. It's just like murdering another person. You have no permission to kill yourself. No permission. Unless, again, if the person was under heavy medication, drugs, he wasn't aware of what he's doing. That's a different story. But just because he lost money in a stock market, he lost $1 million in one day. He has another 20 million. But the pain of losing $1 million, he took a gun and shot his head. Believe me, it happens all the time. What about the other 20 that you have? You're still very well. No, you know, the pain of losing $1 million in 1 hour, Rabbi, you don't understand. The next day, he killed himself. Why? Greed. So what happened? The son is begging her, Mom, you... we're not there. Why didn't you speak? This is what she answered. Listen good. She said to her son, this is our grandmother, 2 generations ago, 60 years ago. She said to her son, you fool. If I would answer, the Jew that writes the protocol will have to write on Shabbat. You don't understand it's Shabbat today? How can I talk? That another Jew would lose his Olam Haba? She made a very big mistake in Halakha, because Hashem says in the Torah, Shabbat is the highest thing, unless if your life is in risk. If a goy comes to you and says, if you don't light a cigarette, I'll kill you. Then you're allowed to smoke. It's a mitzvah to smoke on Shabbat, when the gun of the goy is to your head. Or if the goy comes to you and says, burn the Sefer Torah, if not, I shoot you and I kill you, you have to burn the Sefer Torah. You're not allowed to die. You only have to die. Only if he tells you to kill another Jew. If not, I'll kill you. You have no permission to kill him. If he tells you to bow down one time to an idol, any idol, you're not allowed to agree. And if he tells you to make a sex crime with another woman, you're not allowed to agree. All the three, you have to die. From here we understand what does it mean, boyfriend and girlfriend. They already married way before Hashem agreed to it. That's why there is 70% divorce rate in this generation. Our grandmother, no matter how religious they were, even if they stopped being religious, some of them when they came to Israel, you know, everyone lived far, and they go on Shabbat and bring the grandmother in a car. Supposedly she was Shomeret Shabbat, supposedly, in Iran or in Syria. But now she came to America, to Israel, they come in a car. They help her out, they open the door, they take her. She doesn't understand what's going on. She's an old woman. She didn't even see a car where she was. She didn't see light like today. Everything is different for her. So now when she came here, or she came to Israel, Eventually, what happened to her? She became a mechalel Shabbat. This is what happened to our generation. But this is what I'm trying to say here. That a woman like this never ever dare to have a boyfriend before she got married. In the Arab world, there is plenty of support for murders of innocent Jews. Plenty of support. Many of them will give money and pray for our destruction. It's not a secret. For American destruction and for Jewish destruction, or maybe also European. But none of these filthy murderers, not all of them, a large portion of them support murder. None of these filthy murderers will dare to have a boyfriend before the wedding. Not the man, not the woman. If a woman comes to the wedding not a virgin, she's gonna get killed by whom? Not by the court, by her father and brother. Every country is like this. Go to Syria, go to Morocco. Morocco, it's already Europe. Still like this today. No one of these Fatmot and Saida and Masouda and whatever their name is, none of them dare to let a man touch them before the wedding. And if they did it, for a sin of a moment, believe me, she suffered 10 years after that. And she hide, and they always worry what's going to be. Why? Because of the night of the wedding, they found out she was a used product. That's the end of her and her whole family. Nobody wants to ever look at this family. And this is how it was in the time of the Torah. The Mishnah in Masechet Ketubot. What do you think they learned this from? From us. We forgot what they learned from us. The Mishnah in Ketubot say a man that married a woman give her 200 coins of silver. Silver, there was gold and silver. 200 coins, 200 dinars of silver. If she is a complete brand new product. But if she's a divorced woman or a widow, you only have to give her 100 coins. 50% discount. Why? The value of a brand new woman and a used woman is not the same. This is in the Torah. Why did Hashem made a sign in a woman's body that everybody will be able to know if I'm her first man or not? Why? Because this is what the blessing of the marriage is based on. What do you think? If a woman went from one man to another, and then one day she get married to a man, he's not really officially her first husband. Spiritually, she has a connection to the first boy from high school. That's why 70% of the couples within 4 years get divorced. Everything you do against Hashem, you pay the price. You cannot avoid it. It's better to know it before than to, God forbid, find out when you have 2-3 kids and you have to fight for the kids. Every hour I get a new phone call. Help us, Shalom Bayit, this. All these couples' relationship before the marriage. So I always tell them, you want to save your life? You want to get married? Rule number one, complete separation. Tshuva. I'm sorry, Hashem, I didn't know. I knew a little bit. Forgive me, I'm a fool. Forgive me, I mean, whatever I am. I want to start fresh with you. Give me a chance. I want to marry this girl. I love her. But I already made sins with her. I didn't know, you know, we went to public school together, whatever. I want to start it fresh. It's a lost case. That's it. I have no chance. The answer, nothing cannot be fixed with tshuva. Everything can be fixed with tshuva. Menashe, which I'm going to tell you the story about him in a minute, he made the entire nation of Israel bow down to idols. He made the entire nation go against Hashem. Close to the end of his life, he became religious. And the Gemara say he has a share to the world to come. Somebody like him made a bigger damage than Adolf Hitler. If you come to say to a person, Adolf Hitler, before he died, he made tshuva. And he has a share to the world to come. What would people say? You're crazy. Get out of here. We don't want to hear from you anymore. Hitler has a share to the world to come. Shame on you. Menashe was worse than him. Because the Torah say to murder a person is a very big sin. To make him not religious is a much bigger sin. Gadola machtio yoter min ha'orgo. Making a person lose his eternity is much worse than a person who loses 20 years of his life. Sometimes it can be a rabbi in yeshiva that makes the person lose the religion. with his arrogance, with disrespecting the student, putting him down, making the wrong comments. Look at you, you cannot walk through the door, how much you eat. But this is a little kid, 8th grade, 9th grade, whatever it is, he's very sensitive. From that moment on, he lost his confidence. And from that moment on, he doesn't want to hear from religion. Why? As a kid, he thinks, if this is my rabbi and this is how he talks to me, why do I need this religion? What, to be a monster like him? If my rabbi look like a pig that 500 pounds, all he cares is to eat all day and it's dirty, I want to be like him. That's called Chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem means you walk with the yarmulke, you have a beautiful beard and sombrero, you know a lot of Torah, but you steal, you cheat, you disrespect people, you make instigation between people, you go after their money, you deceive them, you lie to them, you promise to them all kinds of promises. Give me Sefer Torah, achnasat Sefer Torah every week. I want a $10 million building and another one. For what? What are they doing with all these buildings? What do you need 500 Sefer Torah in the basement of the shul? Each one $60,000. What for? You know how many Jews I could save with this money? One price of a Sefer Torah that every week you have achnasat Sefer Torah here. Every week. Every Sefer Torah, I put my line on the life. Every Sefer Torah they put into the shul, I can save 1,000 chilonim with this money. Make them Shomer Shabbat. Every time, remember, every time they invite you to achnasat Sefer Torah, to a shul that already have 80 Sefer Torah in the basement, because another family wants to do a Sefer Torah, remember, this $50,000 or $60,000 or $70,000 that it costs with the silver and everything, you could have made 60,000 CDs and DVDs. I make a test with you. Take 100 non-religious people, give them my disc, Torah and Science, minimum 30 of them will become religious. Guarantee, minimum, from experience I tell you. This is $100, 30 Baalei Tshuva, 1,000, 300 Baalei Tshuva, 60,000, thousands of Baalei Tshuva that will die not religious and marry Christine. Yes, that's what happened. You understand? We are destroying ourselves with our stupidity. Sometimes it's stupidity, but sometimes it's innocent ignorance. Innocent ignorance! Sometimes I spoke to some people, I told him, why did you send the check $7,000 for Hanukkah party? He said, Rabbi, it's the shul. I want to have a party in the shul. I said, what exactly will happen in this shul? They're gonna give donuts and Chinese food, and guys and girls will stand and make scenes. Exchange telephone numbers, and tonight who knows what's gonna happen. First of all, it's disrespect for the house of Hashem. Second of all, the kind of people that come to these parties, you know exactly who they are. So now you help them to get together that they will make Yisurei Karet with your generous donation. Isn't it better to educate these guys and girls to make them finally real Jews? What's the point? To leave them like this, that they think life is only the convertible that I drive and what kind of iPhone I have? That's what Hashem put us here. The truth hurts. It's better to know the truth when you're in your 20s than when you're in your 60s. Because even when you're 60, you can become religious. Nobody stop you. But it's much, much harder. And plus, you lost the best years of your life. You can only make mitzvot 10 years. And then you go to Olam Haba. You are righteous, Hashem forgive your sins, but you're going to kill yourself for the 40 years opportunity that you lost. Male and female, guarantee. So the sixth commandment is you should not kill. How many times the Torah say to a Jew you're not allowed to kill? 3 times. How many times the Torah say you're not allowed to violate my Shabbat? 12 times. No matter how you compare murder to Chilul Shabbat, Chilul Shabbat wins without any doubt that it's a much bigger sin than murder. How many Jews will agree to take an innocent baby, 2 years old, and take his head and drown him in a shower, in a bath, and see how the baby is fighting for his life and die? How many Jews like this you have in the world? I'm not talking crazy people. The world is full of crazy people, I know. But they don't take medication, they need medication. My wife's cousin is working in therapy, psychologist in hospital. I told him, what do you think about Leiby? What do you think about something like this? Do you think this person is normal? There's any chance? He said, of course not. But you know what we have to do? He said to me, we have to praise Hashem and thank Him that it's only one incident like this in the last 30 years. Technically, logically, naturally, something like this should happen every day. He said, if you see the amount of crazy mental people that I see every day coming to get to the hospital, if you see that these people, they were never treated before, 20, 30, 40, 50, this is all psychos. They don't take their medication, or they don't even know they need medication. They leave their children 1 week with a diaper. All the things is dripping on a rug in the house. You come to their house, you see how the house look. This is people who are completely insane, completely. And they are free without any treatment. And you have to know one thing. In the not religious world, people who, God forbid, have children like this that need mental treatment, they go and hospitalize them in mental institution. They even lock them in. They call the police. They put handcuffs and they put him in a hospital jail. Why? Because they want to cure their children, or they want to get rid of them, depending on the situation. Sometimes they destroy the house. You cannot leave. You have a mental kid like this, he's 25, he's in your house, he's doing horrible things, you cannot bring anyone to the house, you cannot trust to leave money in a house, he breaks things, he takes the car in the middle of the night and you find him in the middle of the ocean, he's not normal. So what's the solution? You don't know how to take care of him. Could be a drug addict, could be a lot of things. So they hospitalize them. By the religious world, we have a very serious problem. It's the name of the family, Rabbi. You know what would happen if I send my kid to a mental institution? All my other children will never get married. Because everybody say, oh, I heard you have a brother in Abarbanel, in a crazy institution. We don't want anything to do with your family. So they hide them in a house or send them to places without any supervision, and they become potential murderers. That's what he explained. And this is a professional person. So one case out of 30 years when thousands and thousands of crazy mental people walking around without medication, then it's really a miracle. When in the end now we just found out that technically he wasn't even a Jew. He was born a non-Jew and they adopted him. But that's besides the point, besides the point. The point is, it doesn't matter. It could have been a Jew also, because when a person is not normal, it doesn't matter from what nation he comes. Because when the brain is not functioning, a person is not understanding what he does. Now, I want to conclude what I started before. We connected to the 3 weeks. The Torah say, how do we know that the main reward of our life is all for the eternity and the afterlife? First, the Torah says like this. If you take all the reward of all the people that ever lived in this place, from the time Hashem created Adam until this moment, until the end of the world, all the people combined, all the money they had, all the sports, car, materialism, vacation, women, whatever you can think of, combine everything together from the beginning of their life to the end of their life, multiply by billions of people, make a huge pile of pleasure. It won't be equal to the reward of a religious Jew for 1 hour in the afterlife. That's the opening statement. Yafa sha'a achat shel korat ruach ba'olam haba mikol chaye ha'olam hazeh. 1 hour of pleasure in the afterlife, it's greater than this entire world from the beginning to the end, everything combined. And when the Torah says something, I promise you, it's not a member in the Israeli Knesset. Hashem is not the minister of defense or the prime minister. No. He's not cheating on his wife. He's not stealing bribe to decide from what company to order tanks. No, he doesn't do it. He doesn't do all kinds of things and sell the Jewish lands to the Palestinian hands because they give him $100 million in Switzerland. And he gets all the Israeli people out of their homes because the United States promised him, don't worry, we'll take care of you. Just sign, give all back all the land to the murderers of the Hamas, $100 million, we'll wait for your retirement. They're not doing that. Hashem is not like this. Hashem says, I'm the God of the truth and the justice, who will never accept bribe. How does it possible to think that Hashem will take bribe? The biggest insult, if a person already believes in Hashem, what is he going to think? That I can bribe you with what? With a watch? What am I going to give you? What can I bribe you with? I'll give you my horse. I'll give you my car. I'll give you what? What can I bribe Hashem with? The righteous Jews that make sins, when you ask them, why do you make this sin? Somebody in your level should not do it. Say, don't worry, I'm okay. I have so many mitzvot. I learned so much Torah. I made so many people religious. I have so many zchuyot. Once in a while, I do something bad. Once in a while. When I come to Hashem, I'm going to say, Hashem, I'm 98% righteous, 2% wicked. Let's make a deal. Take from the 2% for my reward, erase all my sins, send me express to heaven. I don't want any punishment. That's what a person thinks. Hashem says, you cannot bribe me with your mitzvot. First, you have to make tshuva before you die for the 2%, or I'm going to clean you up forcefully, afterlife. Or you do it with your free choice, or I'll do it for you. But when I do it for you, it's much more painful. When you can do it right now, it's 100% free choice. But afterlife, it's a dry clean. I'm taking your soul to a place and clean it for you. I promise you, you don't want to go to that cleaning process. None of us wants to be there. If you read a little bit from the Zohar. We can do it right now. Imena nili mili. If I won't take care of my soul, nobody will do the job for me. Ve'im lo achshav ematai. If not now, when? Tomorrow I may not be here. How many Jews got on a bus in Israel and an hour later, who knows where they are? How many people go to drive and who knows what happened? How many people go to take a shower and drink a cup of coffee and they get a heart attack? And I can choke from a bone there's so many things. Surprise! The point is, right now you can still do it. Tomorrow it may not be around, the opportunity. So the Torah says, all the reward cannot be equal to 1 hour. Now I'm going to give you the proof from the Torah that all the reward is for the afterlife. When King Chizkiyahu refused to get married because he saw that he's going to have a very wicked son, Hashem got upset. Because the first mitzvah in Judaism is get married and have children. Purvu, first mitzvah in the Torah from the 613, multiply and have children. Multiply. Don't stay alone. Get a wife, I gave you a woman for a reason, have children. It's a mitzvah. A person has to do everything he can to have at least a boy and a girl. A boy and a girl, at least they have to have a boy and a girl. They can have 10 boys, they did not finish the mitzvah. 10 girls, they did not finish the mitzvah. They had 5 boys, 5 girls, they made the mitzvah. God forbid all of them dying in a plane crash, they go back to zero, they don't have the mitzvah. The mitzvah is that when you leave the world, you have to have at least 1 boy and 1 girl, a girl that can have kids. If the boy is okay and the girl is barren, you did not make the mitzvah, you need another girl. At least 1 boy and 1 girl that can continue your descendants, that's the mitzvah. I know it's not 100% in our hand, but every mitzvah that the Jew did his maximum to do, and he was unable to do, it counts that he did it 100%. We are obligated to do our best. We are not obligated to succeed. We are not obligated to succeed. You did everything you can to be rich because you wanted to build a yeshiva, but you couldn't make the money. You are clean, and Hashem counts for you that you made a yeshiva. You wanted to give money to the poor families, but you don't have for yourself, it counts like you gave. You wanted to make people religious, but you don't know how to talk, it counts like you did. Why? Because you give your life for the mitzvah, and you're unable to do it. So, Hashem sent him the prophet Yeshaya. Yeshaya came to King Chizkiyahu, which was the most righteous king in history. He told him, get ready, you're going to die soon. So he said to him, what sin did I make that I deserve to die? He told him one sin, you did not get married. So he said to him, don't Hashem know that I'm suffering without a wife? All the women want me as a husband. I'm rich, handsome, I'm the king, I'm the smartest, everything. Thousands of offers I can get, but I don't want to get married because I'm going to have a wicked son. I don't want to live this world with a wicked son making idols for people to worship. I suffer for Hashem. And for that, he wants to take me away, young. What's going on here? So he told him, you're right. You're right 100%, but you are not God. When God said to multiply and have children, it's to all people. Nobody is allowed to mix his own opinion when it comes to direct orders in the Torah. This mistake Shaul HaMelech made. King Saul made that mistake. Hashem said to him, clean Amalek, don't leave one. And he left the king, and he left the sheep. And then Samuel, the prophet, came to him and said, what's all this noise of the sheep? He said, well, it was a shame to kill thousands of sheep. It's a lot of money. Instead of killing them, I will sacrifice all of them to Hashem. Better than to just kill them. So the prophet told him, but that's not what God told you. He told you to get rid of all of them. You had to do it. You don't mix your own opinion what's better. Same thing the prophet told King Chizkiyahu. And guess what happened? King Chizkiyahu right away realized he made a mistake, and he said to him, okay, I'm going to make tshuva, I ask Hashem to forgive me, and I want to get married. Please give me your daughter to be my wife. He had a daughter, the prophet. I will marry your daughter, ask Hashem to give me enough years to live that I can have children. The next day, the prophet comes back to him and says, I have good news. Hashem told me tonight, all the prophets received their prophecies in the middle of the night while they were sleeping, except Moshe. Moshe is the only prophet that was alive, up, thinking, walking, speaking, and listening to Hashem. All the other prophets, they had to sleep. They sleep, they receive the prophecy. When they're up, they can't see anything from Hashem, only in the middle of their sleep. But Moshe Rabbeinu, lo kam navi ke Moshe beYisrael, lo kam. While he was up on his feet, he was able to receive prophecy. Everybody else had to sleep. So, he said to him, Hashem gave you 15 more years to live. 15 more years to live. My daughter is your wife. Get married, mazal tov. But the King Chizkiyahu suspected it's too easy. What, just like that, Hashem forgive me? Maybe it's making me feel good. And maybe I'm going to die in a few hours. So he told him, I want you to give me a sign that I'm not going to die. You're the prophet, give me a sign. So he told him, you see the sun? It was afternoon. Today, the sun will not set. No sunset. Instead of 8 o'clock, it should be dark. 10 o'clock, the sun will still be in the middle of the sky. That's the sign that Hashem gave you 15 more years to live. 10 o'clock. Everyone in the Middle East looking up to the sky, what's going on? 10 o'clock and it's still sunny. Some people went to the beach. Nobody went to the beach. Maybe with full clothes, yeah. So, I don't want you to get the wrong idea here. Rabbi, you encourage them to go to the beach up to here. Anyway, so what happened now? Everybody see it's sunny. In Iraq, Nebuchadnezzar, and Nebuzardan, all these wicked people, they all say, what's going on? Today there's no night. So Nebuchadnezzar said to his soldier, get on a horse, I'm riding a letter to the king of Israel. Tell them that to the Jews to explain why today there was no sunset. For sure it's something to do with them. Something in their temple over there. So he wrote, this is what he wrote. To the King Chizkiyahu, and to the people of Jerusalem, and to the people of Israel, and to their God, please explain why the sun did not go down in this date. The soldier got on a horse and was ready to get to his way. This midget got up and he said to him, wait, I made a mistake. He got up from his chair. He went 1, 2, 3 steps. He got the letter back, he erased the name of Hashem from the end of the sentence and moved it to the front, to the God of Israel, to the King Chizkiyahu, to the people of Jerusalem, and to the people of Israel, etc., etc. That's all. One mitzvah he did in his whole life. Other than that, he was 100 times worse than Hitler. Hitler, in his time, 50 million people died, 6 million Jews. But to the Jews, Nebuchadnezzar made a horrible damage. Many millions of Jews died, and he destroyed the temple and took all the Jews and threw them out to the exile. He was a very bad king for us. Listen good now. One mitzvah he made. One time in his life, he respected Hashem. That's it. Three steps. One, two, three. Put Hashem in the beginning of the line. The Gemara say, wow, it's scary. The Gemara say for that, Hashem gave him 70 years of control in the whole world for the three steps that he made to give him respect. The most despicable guy in history. Make no mistake here. The worst. Made three steps to give respect to God. One, two, three, finished. Hashem made him the king of Babylon 45 years. Every person in the world paid him taxes. There was not one person in the world who did not pay him taxes. Millions and millions. The world wasn't 7 billion people, but if it was half a billion, it's still a lot. Every person had to pay the governor of his area, who paid to the king of the land, who pays to him. He has army all over the world. Babylon, you go to Long Island, Babylon. You're all over the United States, Babylon. That's him, Babylon, the dictionary. So much Babylon, it's Babel, it's him. I never knew what Babylon, when I came to America, I said, what is this name, Babylon? Then I realized it's Babel. What happened? What happened now? 45 years he was the king. His son was the king 23 years. And his grandson was the king 2 years. 70 years his family owned the world, not Ocean Parkway. Imagine a guy comes and says, my father is the owner of all Ocean Parkway. Come, sit by the rabbi on the stage. Come, quick, make him coffee. Bring a whiskey a little bit right away. Wow, the Mashiach arrived. He can save the yeshiva. Ooh, how much respect they give him. This is the owner of the whole world. For what? Three steps. Come Chazal and says, this despicable human being that made one mitzvah in his whole life owned the world 70 years for three steps. A Jew walks on Shabbat in 100 degrees like today with humidity, 80% humidity, with his suit and black hat, walks 20 blocks on the Ocean Parkway to get to his synagogue, all dripping sweat, and then on the way back, every Shabbat, 20, 40, 50 years, going every morning, getting up, this, not to move his car because he's afraid of a ticket. He gets up early because he ran to shul. Multiply all the mitzvot that a Jew does. How exactly Hashem will pay in this world? If for three steps that a goy, that was the most despicable one in history, for three steps he received the whole world for 70 years, I walk to shul 3,000 steps on Shabbat. 3,000 divided by 3, it's 1,000 worlds already, just for walking to the shul. And coming back, another 1,000 worlds. Next Shabbat, 4,000 worlds already, multiply by 70 years, there's no room. Even if Hashem wants to pay a Jew for his mitzvot in this temporary life, there is no room. And multiply by all the righteous Jew, how exactly Hashem will share one tiny world to billions of people? It's like one piece of chocolate. You have to give it to 2 million people for 70 years, supply them. No, how are you going to do it? That's why the conclusion, and it's very obvious, and then maybe we give time for questions. The conclusion is very simple. All the reward, 99.99999 until tomorrow, 9 until tomorrow, percent, is all for the next life. Just a little crumb from the cookie, it's to give you enough money and energy to be able to follow the instructions of the Torah. Where does it say in the Torah there is afterlife, that there is eternity when we die? Where does it say, if somebody comes to you, Rabbi, you give a beautiful speech, but I'm still not convinced if when we die, bichlal, we have heaven. How do I know? Maybe we die and we become sand and finish. Do you know anybody came back from there? You know how many times I heard this? The answer, of course. What all we have to do is to prove that the Torah is divine. How do I prove that Torah is divine? I brought you free DVDs over there, Torah and Science. Watch it and I promise you, be convinced. I promise you, take my word, not 99%. You watch it carefully, you will never ever have doubt that this is the truth and life will begin in the time of death. No doubt, I promise you. I don't have time to go into the proofs now. Free DVDs, free MP3s for the car. You listen to it, you'll be convinced. But where does it say in the Torah? The answer is, I'm testing you to see what's in your heart. Are you going to keep my mitzvot or not? It's a verse in the Torah. Ki menaseh Hashem etchem. I'm testing you all the time. You're all in a test. To see, in your heart, I'm checking your heart. Would you follow me and listen to my mitzvot and do it, even though the evil inclination convinces you not to? It's hard. Would you pass the test and do it or not? And what's the purpose of the test? The Torah continue, the same verse. To reward you in your end. Lehativcha beacharitecha. When will I start to reward you? When the end of your life would come, the reward will begin. Now everybody understand the reward is not being in a grave and be eaten by the worms. That's not a reward. What reward Hashem is talking about? Use your head. Where does it say it in another place in the Torah? I'm testing you. I'm strict with you. I'm torturing you to check what's in your heart. Would you still love me or not? That I would benefit you and your children for eternity. Lecha ulevanecha ad olam. I say it in Hebrew that you don't think that I twist the meaning of the verses. For anyone who knows Hebrew, lecha to you, ulevanecha and your children, after you, ad olam, for eternity. Leolam ulolme olamim, forever. Eternity means eternity. A billion years of pleasure, it's not even the beginning of keeping Shabbat. It's not even the beginning of the world of walking with a nice jacket, even though it's a little bit hot for the ladies. Yeah. But there is a huge reward for it. And I'll tell you what happened one time. Reuven asked his friend Shimon if he can do him a favor. In a day like today, 100 degrees in the desert, he told him, you see this mountain over there? Yes. I have my friend Yosef all the way on the top of the mountain and he has a bag full of diamonds. He has to send it to me. You know, UPS doesn't come exactly to the desert on a mountain. So you're going to have to go and get me the diamonds over there. And I really, really appreciate your favor. This is a nice guy, Shimon. He said, okay, you know, let me do a mitzvah. He gets out. He begins to walk 10 minutes. After 10 minutes, he faints already. No water, nobody. He has his cell phone. He sits on the rock, and he cares the day that he was born. I wish I wouldn't come to this world. Why, I have to go all the way to the mountain now. How am I going to do it? After 5 minutes that he's frustrated, his wife calling him up. Shimon, how you doing? Oh, you annoying again. How many times I told you, don't call me every minute. I can't take this anymore. I don't know. What happened? Okay, I'm sorry I called. His wife said, what a husband I have. He's fanatic. So, after Reuven sent him, Reuven is watching him with his binoculars the entire time. And he see how he's frustrated. He's almost crying. Then he gives him a call. Reuven, Shimon, yes, it's Reuven. Oh, not you again. He said, listen, I forgot to tell you one thing. I was busy. I was confused. One thing I forgot to tell you. What he forgot to tell him? When you get there, after you finally get the bag, now actually it's the other way around. He has the bag on his head, on his back, and he has to take it all the way up to this Yosef and give him the bag. So he said, when you get to Yosef, with the bag on your back, Yosef's going to take only 3 specific diamonds that he needs. And all the thousands of other diamonds is your reward for this beautiful journey and for the favor that you are doing to me. This is your reward. Goodbye. What happened now? Like a tiger. He got up from his rock. Two steps up, three steps down. Not in a rush. Running. Oh, his wife calling again. Shimon, I'm sorry, but I have an urgent situation. No problem, darling. Why don't you call me more often? What happened to you? Oh, we are very rich now. Don't worry. You can bother me as much as you want. What really changed? The weather is the same weather. The weight of the bag is the same weight of the bag. The distance is the same distance. Everything stayed the same, except the understanding that I'm not working for nothing. Once I know every mitzvah I keep, I earn so much. Who cares about the difficulty? All these religious people that walk like this, depressed, oof, to get up again, oof, to be modest again, to cover my hair, not to go like this. It's all come from having doubts if Hashem will pay or not pay. That's all. If you come to find a job, you know, sometimes there are clever boss, crooks, clever crooks, goes together sometimes. Somebody comes to get a job and they see that this is an innocent person, naive. So they tell him, okay, let's see how you work for a week and then we'll decide your salary. And already they're thinking, by the end of the week, I'll kick him out and not pay him. Believe me, it's very common. Oh, you're not a good worker. Why did you waste my time? Look. So now the person who worked for a week and he doesn't know what's going to be, doesn't have an energy because he doesn't know how much he's going to make. If he makes, he won't, he cheat me. Doesn't know the man. All week he's worried, would I get, would I not get? After he received the fair salary, wow, so much. The next week is like a lion. Why? Because he's so cash. This is what Hashem said in the Torah. Trust me. Don't save. Don't put man aside. Tomorrow you'll have what to eat. And the next day you have what to eat. You always worry, but you have to trust me. I feed the bugs and the elephants. I feed the Maharashi in India who bow down to Buddha 18 times a day. I won't feed you, my son, the Jew, my daughter. The whole world is for you. I would feed the Hamas terrorist. I would feed Bin Laden. I would feed Arafat. I would feed all these despicable people. But my children who learn Torah and listen to me, I will let them die? What's going through your mind? Everybody will get in the end what they deserve. And since we are in Mill Basin, we'll finish with one story that relates to this place. A few years ago, I went to give a lecture in a place in Queens. And I've been already in this place a few times. There's about 100 secular Jews, guys and girls. Almost nobody's religious there. And I'm setting my laptop. It's a lecture of proofs, like this DVD. I'm setting up my laptop. And a girl, 20 years old, religious girl, very white, scared, real religious, real. And she comes to me and say, you from Muncie, and you have this yeshiva over there. Why can't you find me one guy, you know, American, you know, I grew up here. Her parents came from Russia, an Ashkenazi girl. And I grew up here, you know, she has an American accent. And she said to me, maybe you find me someone who's a real Ben Torah. I want someone who sits and learns Torah. I don't care about anything else. I don't care money, I don't care nothing. Just a real tzaddik that learns Torah. So I tell her, okay, write down your information. I look around, if I have someone, I'll let you know. So she writes on a piece of paper, no. It's very difficult to find her, someone. I hardly know her. 3 months or 2 months later, I come back to the same place and I set up my laptop and there's a couple, married couple, who arranged this event. So I said to her, oh, you know, this time your friend didn't come, I see. She's the friend of the owner of the place. So she said, hey, yeah, she's busy now. She just got married. So I said, wow. Mazal tov, very good, quick. 2 months later, she's already married. So she said to me, you want to hear how she got married? Who cares now how she got married? She had a steak in her wedding instead of chicken. What does it mean how she got married? She married on the water? She married in Las Vegas? I'm thinking to myself, what does it mean you want to hear how she got married? Out of curiosity, and now remember, this is in front of 100 not religious people. I said to her, yeah, what do I care? I'm setting up the wires. So she said when she came to America with her family was so poor that they never had a penny, quarter in her pocket. All the years that we went to school, we went to yeshiva together, she never had money for the bus, not for candy, ice cream, nothing. So ask me how she ended up in yeshiva. It's hundreds of dollars a month. When she came to America with her parents were very poor. They could not afford to send her to yeshiva. So they went to this Russian organization who raised money from Russian Jews to pay tuition to poor Russian Jews that cannot afford yeshiva. That's what they do. So they filled up the application, and now this organization is searching for some Russian millionaire that's willing to sponsor her tuition, year by year. They're looking for people. They found one Russian guy in Mill Basin. Maybe he lives across the street, maybe it's this house, I don't know. It's here, from here. They found a Russian Jew, not religious. Now for sure you're thinking, oh, I know who it is. It was years ago. Remember, when she spoke to me, she was 20. So this was more than 20 years ago, when she was a little kid. Five years old. They came to this Russian secular Jew, and they say, Dimitri, no, it's not his name, I just made it up. So he say, Alex, please, I want to ask you a question. Would you sponsor this girl? It's not bechlal religious, but sometimes, chilonim, they know the truth. And say, you know what, why can't I do something for my future after I make so many sins? Okay, I'll sponsor her. He begin to pay her tuition, and she went to yeshiva. After she spoke to me, she went to the library. Mamash, one more minute and we're done. She went to the library, she sits by the library, and a secular girl comes to her and say, hi, nice to meet you, I'm also Jewish, yeah? I have a shidduch for you. She looks at her, short sleeves, this, what, me like this, and you, what's the connection? She said, my brother. Your brother, who knows, ponytail, earring, who knows what she's gonna find me. She told her, no, I don't think you understand. I'm very religious. I want to marry someone who learned Gemara all his life. So she said to her, no, that's why I came to you. My brother is a Baal Tshuva. He just went to Monsi Or Sameach 6 months. He came back a rabbi. He only wants very religious girl. That's why I think you're going to be a perfect match, you and him. So she thinks, she also desperate to get married. She said, okay, let's go on a date. They go on a date. Perfect match. As this woman had her intuition, she saw 2, 3, 4, 10 dates, whatever it was, up. They decided to make l'chaim. Now she has to bring her Russian poor older parents to meet the family of the guy, to make l'chaim. So they took a car and they drive there. They give them an address. In the middle of the l'chaim party, they found out that the father of the boy is the person who paid her tuition for 18 years, 16 years, whatever it was. The father of the boy that was paying for a girl he doesn't know who she is, never saw her, received her on a platter as his daughter-in-law. True story, it happened. And she heard this that I talk about. In other lecture, I even say her name, but now I'm thinking again, leave the names out. It's on the website if you're curious. I say her name. What's the chances? 7 billion people in the world. 15, 16 years you pay tuition to a girl you don't know who she is. In the end, you prepare her for your son. No, something like this can happen by chance, coincidence. Never, no, never, never, never. Gotta be blind not to see how Hashem turns the world around. Everything we cook, we will be forced to eat. So we have to make sure it's gonna be delicious, not poison. That's my message for you. Thank you very much for having me. Thank you for arranging it. And Bezrat Hashem, we'll meet again. You have free CDs over there. Thank you again. Now you can eat.